Hello and welcome to Bristol Ideas. I'm Andrew Kelly. I'm with Cathy O'Neil. Cathy O'Neil is the author of the best-selling Weapons of Math Destruction. She received her PhD in mathematics from Harvard and has worked in finance, tech, and academia. She launched the LEAD program for data journalism at Columbia University and recently founded ORCAA, an algorithmic auditing company. Cathy O'Neil is a regular contributor to Bloomberg View. And we're talking today about her new book, The Shame Machine. Cathy, thank you very much for joining us.
Thanks for having me, Andrew.
Shame for you is personal and philosophical, isn't it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, well, exactly. Shame, of course, for everyone is personal. Shame, it starts out as a personal thing. My work as a sort of mathematician, data scientist, and journalist came up against shame quite dramatically when I was researching my book, Weapons of Math Destruction, because, well, in a word, I realized that shame was the underlying power that some of these algorithms had. And that fascinated me, especially because as a mathematician, that particular brand of shame wasn't something that would be effective on me. So let me explain. These teachers were being fired based on an algorithm that no one could explain to them. And when I interviewed them, I would ask them, so what did you ask them to explain it to you? And they'd say, yes, they told me it was math and I wouldn't understand it. And I was like, and then what happened? You know, I expected them to say, and then I cussed them out and for, you know, insisted that it was my right to know as a public servant exactly how I was being evaluated. But no, they didn't say that. They basically, the next line was always, yeah, well, I accepted that. I was silenced, you know? So that was just fascinating to me because, as I said, as a mathematician, someone tries to tell me, tries to math shame me, it simply wouldn't work. So it was a strange kind of power to have over somebody.
In the book, you situate the issue of shame within the way you've personally been shamed,
right,
in terms of weight and in terms of diabetes. So
yeah.
just tell us that, what about that experience?
Yeah, and exactly. I mean, it's sort of a follow-up to my observation of what happened to teachers in the face of math shaming. I sort of put that in my pocket, and a couple of years later was researching. I was researching bariatric surgery because I was at risk of getting diabetes. I was like turning 40. My father had gotten diabetes at 40. My brother, 2 years older than me, had gotten diagnosed the year before. So it was like really, and I had all the risk factors, you know, obesity, and I was having more and more trouble exercising. So I was doing my research because I knew that bariatric surgery was a very good treatment for diabetes and it actually prevented it. And I should add, by the way, that I'd been, you know, very fat shamed as a child. I'd spent much of my sort of teenagehood and young adulthood dieting unsuccessfully. At some point, I thought I was over it. You know, I thought I had transcended that entire sort of source of shame. Bariatric surgery is a weight loss surgery primarily, even though it also, you know, should be a diabetes cure, in my opinion. Anyway, as a little context, but I decided this summer my book came out, to like research bariatric surgery. And I was just inundated with fat shaming messages on ad tech, you know, in the ad ecosystem that I had worked on. You know, I knew exactly what was happening. I mean, that was the irony of it. It's like, I know why these ads are being served to me, because I've served ads to people based on their profiles, based on their like search words. So I could even sort of explain it to someone. And yet the effect it had on me was dramatic. It confused me. It baffled me. It made me feel like crawling into a ball. It made me want to pay for a quick fix. It really made me just want to like, how can I make this go away? How can I make this go away? It made me, in a word, cede my rights. And that was the connection to the teachers that I'd seen before. It was like, oh, I get it now. Shame does that. It makes us so feel like fall apart. It's sort of our sense of identity, our sense of self-worth falls apart so dramatically that in that moment of cognitive dissonance where we're like, wait, am I a good person? Am I worthy? Or maybe I'm not worthy. At that moment, you were just willing to sort of grab at straws to try to reestablish yourself.
When I was reading the book, I was thinking back to my school days. In fact, when I went through various periods of being shamed, I can recall many times having to stand in the corner because I'd misbehaved. I can remember dropping down classes at school, which my parents were not happy with and made me feel quite ashamed, really. Growing up relatively poor and living in what we call council housing, you'd call public housing, you felt ashamed in a way in comparison to some of your colleagues. But one of the most cruel things I remember at school I didn't suffer from, which was having free school meals. And the kids at school who had, I went home for lunch, but the kids at school who had the free school meals had to stand in a separate queue. Mm. So everyone knew who they were and they suffered for that. There's no question about that. And I do think some of the things that I felt humiliated by, that I'm ashamed of, did stay with me for a long time. And I didn't have the worst of it, and certainly didn't feel ashamed during a period, for example, when social media existed.
Yeah. Well, there's a lot there, but I just want to jump on that notion that your school had a separate line. I mean, one of the things I kept coming to, just start sticking with the teachers, for example, for a moment, is that the power of that unfair scoring system. By the way, mathematically speaking, that was almost a random number generator, I later found out. It was very meaningless. So one of the reasons they were hesitant to explain it to the teachers is because it was random. It was just a tool of power over the teachers. And it was inherently shaming. And then, because it was just a number that was supposed to evaluate your teaching. And then on top of it, if they asked questions, they got directly shamed. It was a great example, I think, of how shame is used by people in power to maintain a status quo and to blame the victims of a shaming system. So I think that school lunch example that you're just describing is another example of that. And I actually have a section in my book devoted to school lunches and school lunching shame. It's just dramatically terrible. It's the best sort of example, in fact, I think, of what I call punching down shame, if I may. Shaming somebody based on something they cannot choose to conform to, or shaming somebody who has no right to defend themselves or no chance to be redeemed. I think I call those choice and voice. And both of those, of course, are completely obvious when you're talking about children. And moreover, it's an institutional design of a schoolroom, a school lunchroom, that does this. So it's embedded in the actual design of the institution to shame children for being poor. And what it does successfully, besides shaming those children, is it sort of sets up a lifetime of saying, you're poor, it's your fault, you should be ashamed, rather than the alternative, which I think is kind of the reason that we do it this way, which is, this is a society's problem. We need to help folks. We need to decrease inequality. We need to remove dignity violations, and we need to recognize people's humanity. That's just too much work for us as a society. We don't want to do it. We don't want to do that work. We don't want to acknowledge it as a universal problem. So we just blame the victims, and it's just institutionally embedded. And it's a great example.
Let's stay with punching down at the moment, and then come on to the other area. You talk in the book about various examples of this: addiction, obesity, we've talked about, poverty, we've talked about, but also about aging and about dementia and so on. Just tell us a little bit about that.
Yeah, I mean, I was lucky enough to give a TED talk about my first book, Weapons of Mass Destruction, or the themes of that book. And I met an anti-aging activist, an ageism activist, Ashton Applewhite, who really explained to me just how unbelievably ageist we are without even really acknowledging it. It's not the same thing as, you know, fat shame, where fat shame, you're actually just allowed to say, oh, you're fat, you must be lazy. You know, just blame people for being fat. That's just like an actually acceptable form of taunting in at least in the United States. In age, when it comes to ageism, it's just a little bit more subtle than that, but in some sense, more prevalent. So we just, because we talk about ourselves that way, you know, we say, oh, I feel old, you know? There's just, once you start sensitizing yourself to the extent of ageism happening around you, it's just, it's baffling. So it totally makes sense, you know, and it's in fact, I think probably the most traditional profiteering industry that bases itself on shame is the cosmetics industry. You know, probably the first industry that sort of really truly profited directly by saying you should be ashamed of yourself for having natural aging, the natural aging process happening to your body, and in order to like make that go away, quote unquote, because you're not actually going to make that go away, you should buy this product from us and we will make you feel like you're doing something about it. And by the way, not coincidentally, we'll also make you feel like there's a choice in the matter when in fact there is no choice. So that's sort of classic punching down shame, that you're acting as if there is a choice and you should make the right choice and you should buy our product in order to do that. You talked about dementia. One of the topics I enjoyed, as a rule, enjoy debunking pseudoscience. So I grabbed the opportunity in this example, which was the product called Prevagen, which is highly, highly advertised in the US, maybe also in the UK, I'm not sure, but it's really terrible statistics. The ads are sort of in the tradition. One of the things that's different, instead of just shaming women, it actually shames men just as much. So that's an innovation, I guess, which is to say it sort of makes people feel like, oh, if you're older, you must be losing it. See, you must be going senile. You're not as quick as you once were. You have to keep up. And there's a lot of the ads sort of in the theme of you have to keep up with your younger colleagues. And the idea is you take this extract of jellyfish and then you're smarter and you have better memory. There's no evidence to that. The so-called study that they designed failed to come up with anything. So they just did a bunch of like cherry picking of data until they could claim that they had a result, which was absolutely not science. But I mean, I guess the larger point is, well, there's two points. One is that it turns out it's good. It's very profitable because this is a company that's making a huge amount of profit. It's very profitable to shame people based on the natural aging process. And number two, it helps to have pseudoscience backing it. So there's like that kind of authoritative, you know, like you're not a scientist yourself, so you can't ask questions and you should just trust us. That aspect, which I'm always attuned to, because as a mathematician and as a scientist, it is an abuse. It's an abuse of authority and trust.
It's incredibly valuable work you've been doing there. You talked about the shame industrial complex. Could you explain that for us?
Yeah, so I wanted to sort of capture this notion. You know, shame, of course, can happen between two people. And I talk about that as well, but I wanted to capture this larger notion that I was becoming aware of in my sort of observations of shame, where institutions and corporations were either profiting directly by shaming people, or they were sort of institutionally propagating themselves, sort of keeping the status quo fixed by shaming people. So this is sort of the social mechanism of shame was being used to, you know, to profit the institution. One example would be like the Catholic Church. You know, instead of acknowledging the abuse by priests, they shamed the victims for decades just to avoid accountability, right? So there's just a huge amount of, I would call that power power shame, like shaming it by power to hold power, to maintain power. And then there's profiteering shame, which is shaming by companies to make money. Now, I will add, by the way, that there's a new form of that second type, that profiteering type, where instead of in the sort of traditional model, like that the cosmetics industry, the weight loss industry, the sort of even the rehab industry, and for that matter, pharmaceutical companies like Sackler's, which were profiteering off of addiction, that model is like, make people feel ashamed, make them buy your product. There's a new model, and that is social media, which is not directly shaming people to make them buy your product, but rather setting up an environment where people become addicted and conditioned to shame each other, and while they're doing so, profiting off of them. So in other words, Facebook and Instagram and all those other TikTok, all of them, they basically build their algorithms to serve you the content and put you in an environment, designed environment, where you and your friends will be served the most outrageous content from the other nearby but different norm group. So you'll be outraged and you'll sort of lob a shame grenade over the corner of your circle to the next circle over. They will then become outraged that you tried to shame them, and they'll fire back, and you get in these endless cycles. Why does this work? Because it optimizes to profit for the social media engines. And so it is not surprising when you think about it that that what keeps us on Facebook, which is what they optimize to, what that keeps us on is getting into these shaming spirals. Because there's two reasons for that. First of all, shaming feels terrible. It feels terrible to be ashamed. So you really want to punch back as soon as it happens. And number two, which is probably even more important, it feels good to shame other people. It actually feels good. There is a pleasure center stimulation when we shame other people. So that's okay historically, right? We evolved to not just survive in a community, but to police that community to some extent, in order to keep the community cohesive. So there's impulses to shame other people when they break the rules that can be healthy, but it in the age of social media, those sort of healthy impulses have been hijacked to become toxic. And that's actually what we get retweeted for and liked and reposted for. So we get conditioned to do more and more toxic behavior, to perform more and more toxic behavior in the context of shaming and in the context of profiting the social media algorithm, social media platforms.
So you've got punching down, but you also talk about punching up.
Yes.
And perhaps a better use of shaming techniques. Tell us about that.
Yeah, so I mean, I've only talked really about unuseful versions of shame until this moment, but I don't want to make the claim that we should stop shaming. Shame is really important. It, as I pointed out, there's healthy uses of shame. Shame is essentially the way we convince people that there's something that they want, and then there's something that the community that they live in wants or needs, and they have to balance those two issues. They can't just do what they want. They have to sometimes do what the community needs them to do. So an example would be like shaming someone for hoarding food in a famine. You have to share your food in times of scarcity. And that's appropriate. It's appropriate because it saves lives. And the flip side of that is being shamed feels so bad, in large part because in the context of famine and hoarding food, like if you were doing something that was shameful, the threat of being expelled from the community and dying of exposure was real. So it made sense for it to be an existential threat to your existence. So punching up shame, which is basically the opposite of punching down shame, means that you are shaming somebody who has a choice and who has a voice. And again, what that means is like they could conform to the norm they have the choice to, unlike somebody who's poor, who can't just like, oh, I've decided to be rich. They have a voice, which means they can defend themselves if they've been misinterpreted. It means they can be redeemed, which is means that they're going to be seen by the community long enough to be seen improving their behavior. So it's not like a sort of drive-by shaming event where you just shame someone, you never see them again, you lose touch with them, which so often happens on social media. Punching up means I'm watching, and you have a choice and you're making the wrong choice, and we need you to do better.
I think when it comes to holding the powerful to account, for example, we've got a very interesting case in the UK at the moment where our two senior politicians, the Prime Minister and the Chancellor of the Exchequer, having claimed not to have attended parties under lockdown, abiding by the rules that everyone else was expected to abide by, have recently been fined for attending parties during lockdown and have refused to resign. It's a problem compounded by them effectively misleading Parliament, which is should be a resigning matter, in fact. But it is difficult to see, particularly at the moment where the argument is, well, they've apologised, it was a mistake, they paid their fine, but there's bigger issues to deal with, cost of living crisis through to Ukraine, how shaming they can be and what action can be taken against them.
Yeah, and I completely agree with you. This is a sort of perfect setup for punching up shame in the following senses. They have broken norms that they expected other people to agree to, evidently. And so there is a sort of shared norm by which people, and by the way, I should say that punching up, even though it means it's appropriate shame, doesn't mean it's going to work, right? So punching up shame doesn't always work. It requires that the people you're targeting actually share the norm. And it requires that that there's a certain amount of pressure for them to conform beyond just their felt shame. So is the norm truly universal? That's an important question. And I think that's probably the most disappointing thing for the average citizen, is that maybe Boris Johnson didn't actually want, you know, believe in these things, believe in these rules. And that's the hypocrisy that is so so obnoxious. Maybe he doesn't mind misleading Parliament. And that's also something that's shocking, because that's a norm that is expected to be universal. And then the question is there enough pressure to actually force him to do more than just apologize? And of course, I will also, I did in the book, talk about, you know, the fact that there's a difference between an apology and a fake apology and a real apology. I have this notion in my book, which are the phases of shame. And I'll just briefly mention that, like, the first phase of shame is when you just feel ashamed, right? So the possibility that Boris Johnson just never felt ashamed of his actions. So that would really mean that he doesn't share the norm in the first place. So let's put that aside as a possibility, in which case it's just not going to really work unless somebody else makes him resign somehow with some kind of threats. But like, let's put that aside and assume that he did actually feel ashamed of this. The second stage of shame would be like a cognitive dissonance, where you're just like, am I a bad person for this? I don't want to think of myself as a bad person. I will stop thinking about this. So it's kind of a denial phase. Most people have private issues that they feel ashamed of, and they have private interactions with themselves over it. So they can sit in denial, you know, for years, possibly forever. They could get triggered to feel shamed about something again, and then go back in denial. That's typically how people end their lives. They don't really go to the third stage, which Boris Johnson was probably forced to, because it's not something that he can be left alone, right? The third stage would be reckoning. I call it reckoning. So that's a personal reckoning. That's when you say, oh, I really did something wrong. it, by the way, you could also go through reckoning of stages of shame if it's punching down shame, where you recognize, hey, this doesn't work for me. I feel like I went through stage three at the age of 25 when I said diets just don't work for me. And again, even if you go through stage three, you can still be triggered back to stage one, as I was researching bariatric surgery. I felt ashamed, fat shamed again. So then the question is, did Boris Johnson ever get actually reckon with his shame? That's a big question. And then the fourth stage, if one gets there, which is not always true, of course, is when you don't just reckon with it as an individual, but as a society. That's when you say, oh, wow, like people like me are really screwing it up for the rest of the people because we set bad examples and blah, blah, blah. You know, it's like thinking about it as you are not just one person, but as a member of society. It's a social justice issue sometimes. If you're thinking fat shaming, you're like, wow, like the diet industry really makes money off of products that don't work and they charge us money and they make us feel bad for the product failing. You know, that would be stage four of fat shaming. So you can tell when somebody's gone through the reckoning phase, the first or the second reckoning, like as a personal matter or as a social justice matter. If they haven't, let's start there. If they haven't gone through that reckoning, they will say, I'm sorry it made you feel bad. What happened? But because they haven't acknowledged, they haven't reckoned, they haven't acknowledged that what they did was shameful and they can't say it out loud. It's so shocking. It's like actually kind of amazing when you're observing this, when you think through it I'm not saying it's a perfect model for how people go through shame, but it's a pretty good model. And you'll see that when people really have reckoned, they'll say it. Yeah. They're like, oh yeah, I did it wrong. I was wrong. And I hurt people and I'm sorry. And that just makes such a difference because it's a real apology. I haven't studied Boris Johnson's apology, but certainly paying a fine doesn't require reckoning. But giving a true apology does. I have an example in my book of George Wallace, who was a segregationist and virulent segregationist. He's like blocked black children from going into a school at a certain point. And then he was shot. And he was running for president against Shirley Chisholm, a black woman, who visited him in the hospital after being shot. And he was so touched by her humanity and that he really went through the reckoning, not just for himself, but for as a social justice issue, apologized full-throatedly to the black community and was beloved by them after that. And it just goes to show you that you can actually do something much worse than having a party when it's against the rules. If you really truly apologize, people will forgive you. I mean, that's the kind of the optimistic, the best possible thing that we can say about humans is that we actually do forgive each other, but it does take that reckoning to have happened and a real apology. So you'll have to tell me what the apology was like.
Oh, I think it was... I think its seriousness is in question, really. I think that it's on top of statements made in the House of Commons saying that no parties took place, and that it's also on top of the big campaigns that happened in last spring, for example, on making sure that people didn't break lockdown rules because the NHS, our National Health Service, would have been overwhelmed, as any health service would have been overwhelmed if there hadn't been actions taking place. I think most people, certainly the immediate opinion polling suggests that it's disingenuous. Yeah. But of course, these things can change very quickly over these days. So I don't think people accept, and I think the story has a long way to run yet. I mean, it's only the first, for example, of the fines. There are other parties that are being investigated, mm-hmm. and we'll have to see what happens over the next few weeks. Before this, before Ukraine, before the Russian invasion of Ukraine, there were a number of MPs who were lining up for a vote of no confidence in his own party, yeah. in his leadership, yeah. and that was thought that may have gone through. But of course, the international situation has changed that. But it's certainly the feeling I get is that people see it as disingenuous, yeah. But on the other hand, his colleagues are rallying around him.
Yeah, I mean, it's interesting to me that lawyered up apology. I mean, I think you guys have a litigious society. We have a very litigious society. I talk about Harvey Weinstein's like lawyered up apology, non-apology. It is interesting to me because, again, we do forgive people with real apologies. So the lawyered up apology is self-defeating because lawyers never allow you to admit wrongdoing. Mm. But without that admission, it's just a fake apology and it will never actually clear you. So I don't know really what lawyers think that they're accomplishing. they're just sort of extending the conversation longer, which is not to the benefit of the person who's trying to get the conversation to move forward. And I think you're right that the war in Ukraine, is probably the distraction that Boris Johnson wanted and possibly needed to end this conversation. But it might just continue. Like once people get used to the shock of this European war, I feel like they're going to pay back, start paying more attention to domestic matters again.
I just wanted to ask you about a couple of other cases, actually. You mentioned Harvey Weinstein was one of them. So you talk about a number of successful cases of punching up. Larry Kramer's work, for example, was one during the AIDS crisis. And the second one, interestingly, going much further back, was the work of Mahatma Gandhi. Could you just tell us a little bit about both those two?
Yeah, well, so Larry Kramer was an AIDS activist, gay man, who, and I wanted to include his example because he was just simply sort of reviled as just too much at all times. It was just like going too far. He was too extreme. He was outrageous, which he was for the norms of the time. And I wanted to make the point that like punching up is never considered polite. Shame is not a polite tool. Shame is a very crude, vicious tool, actually. Sometimes it's the only tool. And so for civil rights movements, it is sometimes the only tool. Mahatma Gandhi's salt march, I talk about how he was viciously punching up at the British Empire for just not living up to their own stated ideals. So there's a norm there. And he was saying, you're not what you claim to be. You're hypocritical. And that's never polite, right? It's brutal. To actually punch up successfully requires you to topple the status quo, to expose them as cowards and hypocrites, and to force their hand. And these are people who are in power. They don't want to change. And that's why for that matter, Martin Luther King, we have a Martin Luther King Day in the United States. People always pull out the sweetest, most peace-loving quotes that he said. It's highly edited. It's a very sort of sanitized version of his actual speeches, which were much more progressive and fiery. And it should be said that as much as like we all claim to love Martin Luther King today, he was actually hated at the time because, again, he was punching up and he was doing it well. Mm. And so he was not considered civil. That was the biggest complaint. He's asking for too much too soon. It's not civilized. So one of the most interesting things about punching up is that it's sometimes the only way progress is made and norms are changed. And Me Too is the sort of the movement I referred to with respect to Harvey Weinstein. It doesn't look good for the folks who are being targeted, right? They don't like it. They complain about it. They think it's going too far. It's uncivil. It's, how was I supposed to know? Give me a pass because I was raised in a different time, blah, blah, blah. The point is that, yes, it feels bad to be punched up at. You shouldn't expect if you join a civil rights movement that people will thank you for it. People will, in fact, tell you to stop because it looks bad. And that isn't a sign that you should necessarily stop if what you're doing is what you think is right. But you should, of course, make sure that it is, in fact, punching up, that it's not just punching down in a performative way.
I want to move on to how this can be used progressively now. But just before that, you refer in the book, which is a big debate here in certain circles, about cancel culture. How serious a problem do you think this is? Or is it a problem at all?
Oh, I think cancel culture is real. I think there is a chilling effect based on the policing of everyday people on social media. Unfortunately, there's a sort of, again, there's a kind of pseudoscience going on, if you don't mind me saying it this way, of like selection bias, that the people who are most loudly complaining about cancel culture are the very people who have a voice and probably made a bad choice and were shamed for it and don't like it, right? So the true people that are being canceled, the people that are truly being canceled, I should say, are being silenced. You don't hear from them. They're people who like make a mistake and are get publicly shamed for it, and you never hear from them again. And or the people that, you know, never get a job because of something they posted or a friend posted on social media that makes them look bad. You just don't hear from those folks. You hear from the people who don't like having consequences to their actions. So it's this ironic thing where the very people complaining about cancel culture are probably not the ones that are suffering from cancel culture. But I would say that if you sort of imagine on, and this is the way I frame it, it's like I started a blog in 2010 and I really experimented with ideas. I was wrong half the time. People corrected me and I thanked them. And I said, thank you for correcting me because it is a faster way to learn. And I'm going to come out tomorrow with another idea, which might be wrong. And thank you for correcting me tomorrow if I'm wrong. That's just not something I would do right now, or I don't know anybody who would do that because the benefit of the doubt, the assumption of the benefit of the doubt is no longer there because we have so many ways to be embarrassed and shamed for making mistakes and that we know will live with us forever. And I just don't, and so I just do think cancel culture is real, but I don't think it's being characterized, it's not being represented by the complaints about it.
I think one of the problems with social media is that ability to trawl back and see things that have said a long time ago. I mean, I'm just absolutely thankful that it wasn't around when I was younger, for example, because of the kind of things that I know that I said, which were not, I don't think, particularly dangerous or whatever, but you might not wish to be reminded of them sometimes. And the implications are just so intense now, I think. So how do we use shame in a positive way? I mean, it presumably you've got to be really careful how you use it. You've got to be, you know, don't victimize people.
Yeah. Well, look, there's two levels that I'm going to give advice. The first level is individual. I will advise people to recognize shame when it's happening. So this is a lens through which to see shame. I want to think punching up, punching down. Is it bullying? Is it appropriate? Will it work? I want you to analyze that before you engage, or even analyze it when you see it happening to other people and go to the defense of somebody who's being punched down on. But also just don't punch down on people yourself, like including your children, by the way. Don't shame your children for something they can't control, like their body. Very basic things like that. Don't try to control your child's eating. That is inherently shaming and punching down. So individually speaking, I would say aim higher. But just as important, I think, because I want to aim higher. I'm not trying to blame people for falling victim to the purposeful design, the intentional design of social media. If it's happening to you, it's because you're on social media. You know what I mean? It's like you're a pawn in their game. They've gotten you to work for free for them. So I really want to aim higher, and I want to say social media has to be designed better. I want to say that our prison system in the States is inherently a shaming machine. Our welfare system is a shaming machine. Our rehab system is a shaming machine. That people who have the power to design institutions, they must design institutions to avoid punching down shame. And I have this handy way of thinking about that, which comes from Donna Hicks, who is a really interesting woman who sort of negotiates peace treaties and reconciliation conversations after wars. She has this list of dignity violations, and that she claims that people need to get through, they need to sort of sort through the dignity violations that they experience before they can go on to a peace treaty. I feel like the dignity violations as a list, it really encapsulates quite well sort of the signs that your institution is punching down, is inherently shaming. And so what we want to do is design institutions to avoid the dignity violations. And so that's the more important specific call I'd have for people who read the book, is that if you are part of a design of a system of an institution, avoid dignity violations, because it's going to improve that shaming situation.
And I think there's also, you know, critically important what you talk about towards the end of the book about the kind of having the basic services that a good society should have, you know, the free childcare, the decent education, a roof over your head, a job, the chance to work. And even when their jobs aren't there for some people, having some kind of guaranteed income program.
Yeah, I mean, from my perspective, the inherently undignified situation of being, you know, deeply impoverished is something we can and should avoid. We should take it upon ourselves to control it. And we have that capacity. We just simply choose to blame the victims of these sort of society-wide scourges instead of addressing it directly. So I think that would be certainly the most direct way of countering poverty shame is to give people money. Mm. A large part of the shame of poverty is shaming people for taking welfare. And in fact, like a large chunk of people who are eligible for welfare don't get it because of the shame attached to it. And of course, because of stupid bureaucratic, intentionally shaming processes like paperwork. And when you think about the fact that like half of the poor people living in poverty in the United States are actually children, you realize just how completely unreasonable this is. It's unreasonable for anybody, but it's deeply, deeply unfair, unreasonable, and shameful for us. Shame on us for letting that happen. So yes, I think it's pretty clear what we need to do.
And a final question, because it's an issue for us here as well. I mean, Bristol was one of the leading cities in the trade in enslaved African people, for example, and there's been talk about reparations here as well. And that's something which you cover in your book as well.
Yeah. Yeah. So I wasn't the person who invented this, and I won't quote her perfectly, but I found someone who said something along the lines of, you know, if we can be proud of our heritage, then we can be ashamed of our past. I devote some part of my chapter to the concept of white shame. And in the United States, we, as a society, managed to talk all the time about all the people in our ancestors that we're proud of, and all the American innovations and the American way and the American dream, and for that matter, Manifest Destiny, which is part of that whole story. But it really was an excuse to kill Native Americans and then to have slavery. Somehow we have claimed to have shed responsibility for our past shameful acts, but we haven't also gotten rid of the things that we're proud of. I don't think that it makes sense. What I think is actually happening is that as a society, we're stuck in sort of phase two of the shame system. So we're in denial. We're in that cognitive dissonance denial phase. We haven't really gotten through to the reckoning, not as a society. As you know, we saw some progress after the George Floyd murder. As a society, we saw more people saying, this is just wrong. Racism is wrong. Police brutality on our Black men is wrong. So we have seen some amount of reckoning, but we haven't as a country finished that job. And of course, part of that reckoning would require reparations. So I'm sure that there's a similar story that could be told in the UK.
Yeah, no, absolutely. Thank you, Cathy O'Neil, for joining us today. The Shame Machine is published by Alan Lane and is available now. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Andrew. Thanks for having me.